So hello friends, welcome again to Mosti Academy JUPEB 2022 preparatory class. Today we are looking into the JUPEB chemistry, A-level chemistry as you all know. And we are going to be solving the 50 questions of JUPEB 2020 so as to get ourselves prepared and do some kind of revision with respect to what you have studied in your different institution and coaching centers. So I'm going to be providing quick solution as usual. Those 50 questions, if you have any additions or any form of contribution or questions you want to ask, you can send mail to me or drop a comment in the comment section. So as usual, if you are new to this channel, you can consider subscribing to us and also click on the notification. So let's get started with the question. The first question. Which of the following statement is incorrect? An atom is electrically neutral. Yes, that is the correct statement. As you know, that atom is what? The atom has no charge. They are neutral. The size of a cation is smaller than that of the corresponding atom. Now, cations are positively charged. We can take an example, maybe Ca2+. Compare it with Ca. It goes without saying because Ca is losing two electrons. So you expect cations to be smaller than the atom. So this is also a correct statement. The third one says the size of an ion is bigger than, you can see it, which will be. We can take chlorine minus and chlorine atom. It goes without saying that what? This has more because it has gained an electron, and that makes this statement correct. So if these three statements are correct, the incorrect statement out of all these will be choice D, as an atom and its ions have an equal number of protons. Atom and ions have the same number of protons. I believe you have studied that in your junior classes. The next question. Thank you very much. Now, the second question here is Brosted-Lowry base is dash. That is, we are looking for definition of Brosted-Lowry, definition of base. Now, from junior classes, you also might have studied that acid, base, and salt. Now, under your ionic equilibrium chapter, A-level student, you have different definitions to acid, base, and salt. Arrhenius, Lewis, anyhow you pronounce, and the last one, which is what? Brosted-Lowry. Now, Brosted-Lowry defined acid and base in terms of proton donor. Acid is defined. Acid is a proton donor. Whereby base will be the opposite of donor. You know the opposite of. So base is a proton acceptor. So that is the definition of Brosted-Lowry. Whereby Lewis defined what? Acid as what? Electron pair acceptor. And base as what? Electron pair donor. So you just need to be careful. Your own question this year might be on the aspect of definition with respect to Lewis acid and Lewis base. So answer to this one, what we have here is nothing but choice B. The next question. Thank you very much. Now the next question says, which rule states that no two electrons in an atom can have the set of quantum numbers? This is very, very simple, and I think it is basic. So under your topic of quantization, you have studied or quantum number. Talk about N, L, M, S. So remember azimuthal, principal quantum number, azimuthal from magnetic, and the spin quantum number. Then according to Pauli exclusive what on exclusion principle, we state that what? No two electrons can have the same set of four quantum numbers. It is not possible. So this is the definition of our Pauli exclusion principle, and that is the answer. You guys should remember once rule about talking about two sets of electrons and not what they enter singly before what PN. All these might have been studied in your junior classes. Next one, guys. Next one, please. Thank you very much. We have the first calculation of today, and according to this one, we are given calculate the relative molecular mass of a gaseous compound if evil. 13.15 gram of the compound occupies 4.80 DMK at STP. Admin, am I good to go? Now, here we have, from what we have studied, stoichiometry, that is the topic. You have been told that number of mole equals to mass given over 22.4 decimeter cube. So here, I think I'm going to be in need of calculator. So while waiting for calculator to pop up, number of mole is mass given over 22.4. Let's do that. The mass given here is 13.15 divided by 22.4 DMQ. So this is the number of mole of that substance. Similarly, from junior classes, we have also studied that number of mole is equal to mass over molar mass. I think that is also very popular in junior classes, molar mass or molecular mass. So if you have studied this, now you know the number of moles to be this answer. Because I will just make a calculator once. That is 13.15 over 22.4 was the answer for my numbers of mole. Is now equals to, you are looking for the molar mass, is equals to mass. Oh, hello, I think I have made a mistake, which I think I have to quickly change now. Now, the number of mole is equals to volume over 22.4. So, coming about that, I'm going to bring this back. Just permit me. So, wow. I have time. So this is supposed to be this. So it should be volume over 22.4. Wow. So apologies guys, I just have to get this thing done. So volume over 22.4. Wow. So it should be the value of the volume there, not this. So the volume here is the value of volume given, 4.80. I will need a calculator, notwithstanding, it's 4.80. So I'm counting this. So 4.80 should be what I'm going to have here. So the razor, please come. I'm please doing this through my life. I have a lot of things to do here. So this is okay. This should be 4.80. I hope students are still with me. So 4.80 over 22. So number of, I'm now using this, is now mass over molar mass. So the mass here is 13.15. Because I don't have calculator, that is why I'm taking 13.15 over molar mass. So that's that. So now I just make molar mass the formula. Calculator with you just takes is allowed in your exam. Molar mass will be, you know, it's just like a form of simple math. So molar mass will just be equals to this times this over this. 22.4 times 13.15. I wasted time on that. It's a simple question. Divided by 4.80. So molar mass answer, I hope I am not cutting, is equals to approximately, it should be 61, please. And you can let me confirm with manual calculator, but I think I am very right on this one. I've gotten this. So that should be the right answer. So 61 approximately. So thank you very much. So 61 is correct for this. So I think this is the next question. So please, you can always confirm that. That is why I'm trying to do. Now, next one. The next question says, which of the following species has the same electronic configuration? You are looking for isoelectronic. Now, for isoelectronic substance, this is Al3+. So, everybody knows. Al3+, atomic number is 13. It has lost 3 electrons. And because of that, it has now turned towards neon, which is number 10. I also remember neon is number 10, according to your periodic table. Very good. Now, from here, we have, which of these is neon? You can see this is fluorine. Fluorine is number 9. I have F minus has gained 1 electron and has become neon 2. So the answer to this will be nothing but fluorine. The next question. Now, thank you very much. What is the volume of oxygen required to burn completely 45 centimeter cube of methane. So we have to write the correct equation of what? Combustion reaction of methane. So writing that, methane is a CH4. It will react or undergo combustion reaction. This is a gas. This is also a gas. And when this happens, it's going to give us carbon 4 oxide, complete combustion, plus water. I hope students have studied this. Now, if you try to balance the equation, which you can do, this is 1 plus 1, that is 2. Then this is 1, and this is 4 over 2 is also 2. I hope the question is balanced. The equation should be balanced like that. So if the equation is balanced, we can now go by the comparison of methane. From here, 1 mole of methane balances 2 moles of oxygen. And we are comparing volume of oxygen with respect to methane. You can see here that methane volume is given. And because methane volume is given as 45, so if methane is 45, 1 is 45, 2 will be equals to 90. As 45 times 2 and 90. And that is why choice C is very correct. The next question. Thank you very much. Now, which of the following is true regarding the precipitation reaction? Method of what? Precipitation. Separating what? Insoluble salt. I hope you have studied that experimentally in junior classes. Now, both products are, no, one of the products must be insoluble. That is the basis of what? Precipitation. Now, at least one of the products will be insoluble. Not this, at least one. At least one of the products will be insoluble. At least one. That means one can be insoluble, but the other is what? Insoluble. Now, let's check another option. At least one of the reactants must be not the product, because the product is not what you are what you are actually dissolving. So please note that. So that is wrong. So we say at least one of the reactants must be insoluble in water. Not the reactant as well, but what? The ions. The ions must be what? Insoluble. So spectator ions form insoluble salt. Yes. This is the concept of what? Precipitation reaction. So guys, that is the answer to that. The next question, please. Thank you very much. Now, arrange the following in the order of increasing boiling point. Talking about boiling point, you use your concept of bonding. You remember bond? So just try to understand the bond that exists between each of these methods. It goes without saying this is electrovalent, or you say ionic bond. This is covalent, because you know the bond that exists. And this hydrogen cyanide is more like saying it is a kind of Van der Waals force, or it's a hydrogen bond. So if you go with this, arrange that from an increasing order. That means from lowest to highest. I hope you guys know what we mean by lowest to highest. So electrovalent bond will be the one that carries the highest. So definitely it should be the low, it should be the last one. So these two options, I'm going to cancel them out. So after that, I can now consider the next one. After that, I should think about the Van der Waals force that exists between covalent bond. So that one should be the next strongest. Then the weakest force should be this. Because listen, hydrogen cyanide, the bond that would exist between hydrogen is a kind of dipole force. So it is not a kind of hydrogen bond. Hydrogen bond exists between hydrogen and an electronegative substance. What is the problem, please? So please, if you guys don't know more about bonding, you can watch some of my online video on chemical bondage to understand a lot about it. So what I'm saying is that, now it is between these two. Now without wasting your time, what I'm trying to say is that this will be greater than this. So option B is the most correct answer according to the question. The next one, please. Now, thank you very much. Still on bonding, the electronegativity values of silicon and hydrogen is 1.8 and 2.1. The concept of chemical bonding is also what the examiner is testing here. And if you want to actually understand this, what we use in this type of is if the gap between the two electronegativity of what of a substance is large,
The bond that exists between such compounds is ionic bond. I hope you have studied that.
But if the electronegativity gap is low,
we say the bond is what? Excuse me, covalent bond.
Now, in this type, if they are now very, very close, in this case now, you can see 1.8 is very close to 2.1.
So the bond that exists there is called dative, or what you guys call coordinate.
Coordinate bond. Again, you can also use the element or the compound that is in the question to know this. This is silicon hydride. Silicon combined with hydrogen. I've done this also under the carbon family. You can watch video on that. To give you SiH4. So this SiH4, which we call silicon, only reacts with nitrogen.
And also reacts with concentrated NaOH. So those are the only things that in which silicon can what? Combine directly with.
Now, we give you, if you don't know this first concept, if you have studied carbon and its compound, you know the bond that exists between this silicon and hydrogen is called a dative bond, which is also known as what? Coordinate, what? Covalent bond. So it depends on how you have studied the concept to know the right answer. The next question. Thank you very much. Now, when an atom is oxidized, oxidation, the oxidation number dash, this is elementary under the concept of redox. So if you have studied redox also, you will be told that what? Redox oxidation number increase in oxidation state is called oxidation. Increase in oxidation number is called oxidation. Whereby oxidation is also defined as the loss of electrons. Oxidation number is increase, then electron is what? Lost. That's the definition. Oxidation is loss. Oil, green. Reduction is gain. I hope you still remember that elementary concept. So, oxidation is loss. Electron is loss. Or increase in oxidation number is choice D. So, D is correct. To the next one. Thank you. Now, the next question. Apologies. What mass of carbon 4 oxide is formed when 60 grams of carbon is burned in 750 grams of oxygen? So the first thing we write here is the equation of reaction between carbon and oxygen to give us CO2. Everybody knows the equation is balanced, and we can move. Now, in this case, we know each values of the masses. Mass of carbon is 60. Then oxygen is 750. Then now we are looking for the mass of this one. I call it X. Use the concept of moles documentary. Then you are going to see that guy is what? A limiting reagent. Now if you use the concept of moles, we just did that. You can say the number of moles is equals to mass. The mass of this guy is a mass over molar mass. 60 divided by molar mass of carbon. Barely given, divided by 12. So N equals to, this is 5. So if 5 moles, this is 5. So from the equation, 1 mole of this one can require 1 mole of this one. As you can see, 1, and require 1 mole of this. So what I'm trying to say is that if 1 mole of this is 5, as a 1 mole of carbon is giving 1 mole of CO2. So N, the one that is 1 here, is giving us 5. So if 5 is the number of mole of this one, 5 will also be the number of mole of this one. Now you can also say, why am I not using this one? 750 divided by 0.2, 16 times 2, 32. If you look at this one, this is going to give you something like a decimal point. The mole is not what? An whole number. Please note that. So that's what I'm taking it as. Maybe what? The kind of a limiting ingredient. So what I'm saying, if 1 mole of this requires 1 mole of this, 5 moles of C also require 5 moles of CO2. So that means the same number of moles is acting between them. And if you have that, we can now say number of moles is equals to the mass which we are looking for divided by the molar mass. I am not rushing because I believe most of us are not that good in chemistry. As I'm taking my time slowly. Now, number of moles there is 5. Molar mass of CO2. You guys can calculate. CO2 should be 44. 12 plus 16. 12 plus 33 is 44, 44 grams. So that is 44 times 5 from cross multiplication. I'm looking for mass. I hope you can see this. Some simple calculation. 44 times 5 should be like 1,
160 or 220. 44 times 5 is 220. So this will be the correct answer. I have used this simple formula for those who are just joining us. That is 5 is equals to mass over 44. So when you cross multiply, I think you are going to have this. So next question. Thank you. Now, a solution capable of resisting change in pH, that is a buffer solution. That is what we call a buffer solution. I think you have studied that in your junior classes under the concept of ionic equilibrium, acid base, and salt. Next question. Thank you. Next question says, what is the percentage by mass of carbon present in 6 grams of hydrocarbon which bonds completely in air to produce 11.0 gram? I don't want to block the viewer. That is what I'm trying to do. And if I'm to increase the pace of this one, yeah. I'm sorry, guys. Apologies. I'm to increase the size of that for you guys to see very well. Let's see if I can get that one done. And if I cannot get it done, we can still move on. It's not a problem. You can enlarge the image. So I don't want something that will be, I think, is this what I'm doing now? I think this is the question. So we have, what is the percentage by mass of carbon present in 6.0 gram of this? I'm trying to enlarge that. I think I'm going to have issues doing that. So I'm going to disturb myself doing what is going to give me a problem. So now, no time, because I still have a long way to go. That's just the truth about all this. I still have a long way to go, to be honest. So please, guys, let's just manage what we have here.
We can say from here, because it is an hydrocarbon and it bonds, so we are going to write the standard equation of what hydrocarbon. So writing that, we can say CXHY. We bond in X plus Y over 4 oxygen, writing the standard equation of our combustion reaction to give you CO2, that is XCO2 plus Y over 2 H2O. This is the standard equation of our combustion reaction, which I believe you might have studied. And if you haven't, there's a first time to everything in this stuff. Now, having said that, I can now compare this to get the value of my X and Y. I'm going to form something like a sixth term of equation, which is going to help me. Now let's look at this. We have percentage by mass of 6 grams of hydrocarbon. This hydrocarbon, so CXHY is 6. That's the total gram. 6.0 is the same thing as 6. It bonds to produce air. Air is oxygen. To produce 11 grams of carbon 4 oxide. Where's carbon 4 oxide? This is it. So that means XCO2 is equals to 11. From here, I can calculate the value of X, because you and I know that CO2 is 44 from molar mass, right? Just did that now. So that's 44 times X. You can say 44X, I hope I am not cutting, is equals to 11. What do I know? I can get X here as 11 over 44. See, 11 here 1, 11 here 4. So instead of writing that 0.25, I can say X equals to 1 over 4. I mean, hope that is showing. Thank you. So that's the amount of X. Now the hydrocarbon has X. In fact, the part that has X in the hydrocarbon is what? Is the family of what? What's it called? The family of carbon. So let's do the same thing. We know the value of X. X is 1 over 4. So what is carbon? 12. Now I did 12 plus 16 times 2 there. So I'm also going to do the same thing here, just for you guys to understand what I'm doing. This is why I'm taking my time. So carbon is 12. 12 times X. X is 1 over 4. 12 times 1 over 4. If I want to get Y, but I don't think the question asks for Y, I'm looking for the percentage of carbon. So let me get the value of carbon here. So 12 times X plus, you know, hydrogen is 1. 1 times Y will be Y. Is equals to 6. So I can get Y. If the question asks me to know the amount of what? Hydrogen, that is what, in the hydrocarbon. But the question did not ask, only the percentage of carbon in it. So what is the percentage of carbon here? 12 divided by 4 is 3. So
So if 3 is the amount of carbon, 3 plus y equals to 6, y is also equals to 3, I don't need y. I say that. So the amount of carbon that is reacting in this substance is what? Only 3 grams. Out of the total hydrocarbon mass is what? 6. So therefore, percentage composition is 3 of carbon. I'm looking for the amount of carbon. That's a simple question that is reacting out of the whole hydrocarbon. 3 of carbon, 3 out of 6 times 100. That's percentage. That's half of 100. That is a 50%. So these are ways you solve questions of this nature, and this will make option C to be valid. The next question. Thank you. Now, in which of the following, let's increase our pace a little bit. Is sp2 hybrid orbital not involved? Hybridization, and I think this one is very, very simple. If you know, blend the concept of what we call VSEPR. So if you blend that concept of VSEPR, it is very easy to know that it's a simple question. Then knowing the shape of what? Of the molecule. And also, if you watch, out of all this, this is, you know, if you know the shape of the molecule, I don't think this is going to give you any issue. Now, without wasting time, sp2 is not present in CO2, because CO2 has a linear shape. And the linear shape from hybridization is sp hybridized. You don't need to waste your time. This one, you know, this is sp2 hybridized, and that is how we call it what? Triagonal. You know the shape. When I say triagonal, I don't mean triagonal pyramidal. Please note. Then BF3, how do you get this? You know, if there are 4 bond atoms, that is a lone pair. If you have 4 is sp3, you know the logic. 3 is sp2, and 2 is what? Sp. So, we're talking about your bond pair and your lone pair. I don't want to go into details now because we still have a long way to go. The next question. So, the answer to this is D. D is a linear shape and is sp hybridized. Others, you can get the hybridization, very simple to get. Others are sp2, and you know their shape. Please, next question. Thank you very much. Oh, wow, this is very simple. Calculate the standard electromotive force in volt of a cell that uses half cell reaction of this, that is EMF, is E left minus E right. So E left minus E right, we change the sign of this one, that is a minus times minus is plus 0.44 minus 0.25. 0.44 minus plus times minus is minus. So no need to waste time. So 0.44 minus 0.25. So now I mean, I think this should be something like 19 plus 25 is 44. So this should be the answer to that. 0.19. I hope students know how to do this. A left minus A right is the logic we use. The next question, please. Thank you very much. Now the next question is, what is the oxidation number in what? Sodium peroxide. Peroxide, negative 1, nothing to solve. Peroxide and superoxide. Peroxide is negative 1, superoxide is what? 1 over 2. Next question, I will please. Thank you very much. The next question is question on your electrochemistry or heat and thermodynamics. Now, if the enthalpy of a given reaction is negative 215 kilojoules per mole, and the entropy of the reaction is 152 joules per mole, per Kelvin, whatever, and that one is kilojoule or joule, I just need to know, and the temperature is needed to be 30. So directly I can say delta G is equals to delta H minus T delta H. I think this is also popular in junior classes. So if it is negative, hope you know, if it is zero, it is at equilibrium. If it is negative, it is what? Spontaneous. If it is positive, it is what? Non-spontaneous. So now let's see the answer of delta G. Is negative. Now, how do I know? Let me just check. What is my enthalpy? Enthalpy. Enthalpy is a negative 216 minus 215. The only thing is, if I have minus of delta X and I don't have minus, it's positive. See, temperature is 303. I'm converting to Kelvin. So this is 303 multiplied by delta S is 115.2. Do I have to change from kilojoule to joule or whatever? But notwithstanding, what I'm trying to say is that even if I change from kilojoule to joule or joule to kilojoule, What I'm trying to tell you is that the answer will still be negative because this is positive. The only thing I can change this one to positive is if the value of this one is what? Is negative. So that is the only thing. But in this situation, my answer will be what? Negative answer. And negative answers tells me that it is what? A spontaneous reaction. So please admit, you can move to the next class, right? Next question. Thank you. Now, the next question says, the temperature and pressure at which three phases of pure water exist. What do you call three phases of water? That is what? Triple point. Excuse me, triple point. And I believe you have studied that triple points occur at a temperature of 273 Kelvin and 1 atmosphere, or you have 273 Kelvin or 0.01 degrees Celsius, and it is always what? 1 atmosphere or 4.5 millimeter of mercury. This is what? This is not a concept based question, it's a question on memory base. So it's a question of memory base. So if it is memory base, you can see 273 and 1 atmosphere. This is 298, so this is wrong. 273 and not, this is wrong. Now that means the answer is not in Kelvin, it's in Celsius. So 273 Celsius divided by Kelvin is 0.01 Celsius and 4.5 millimeter of mercury. So temperature and pressure at which what triple point exists in a liquid is 0.01 degrees Celsius. And 4.5 millimeter of mercury. So choice C is correct. We can move to the next question. Thank you, Admin. Now, the pH of a buffer solution depends on the concentration of dash. Now, pH of a solution, we say buffer solution is not affected by what? By pH. Or resist the change in pH. The only factor that affects is what? The amount of acid and base that is used to prepare the solution. So both conjugate acid and conjugate base are the factor that affect the concentration of what? Of what? Buffer solution. So you can say the answer to this is not, is both A and B. And we have D that carries the two answers. And that is how to get answers to questions. Next one. Thank you. Now, the next question is question on mole ratio. What is the mole fraction of oxygen? What is the mole fraction of oxygen gas in a mixture of containing 32 gram of oxygen, 32 gram of methane, and 32 gram of SO2? We have studied up to now that number of mole is mass over molar mass. So let's get number of moles of each of them. Mass, oxygen is also 32. As 32 over 32 is 1. We can also get, this is for oxygen. You can get for, let's use different things. Number of mole for, the next gas is what? Methane. Mass of methane is also 32. Molar mass of methane, CH4. 12 plus, that's 16. Methane is 16. So 12, this is 16. This is giving me 2. This guy is 1. That guy is 2 moles. And the last substance is SO2. Number of moles of SO2 is mass of SO2 is also 32. Molar mass of SO2 is 64. I hope students can get that. So this is 0.5. So these are the moles. So the total number of moles in the mixture will be the addition of the three moles. 1 plus 2 plus 0.5. So number of moles, N total. N total will be equals to, we have N total is equals to 1 plus 2 plus 0.5, and that is 3.5 moles. The mixture has the three of them. So, but the question asks you to find the mole fraction of what? Of oxygen. So, where is oxygen? 1 out of 3.5. So, therefore, now say mole fraction. I hope I am not cutting what I'm writing, please. What is not cutting? Mole fraction of oxygen. It's now equals to 1 over, oxygen is 1 mole out of 3.5. That is what I'm doing, guys. And 1 divided by 3.5 should be something like 0.286. I mean, this one, let me check. So 0.286 should be 1 divided by 3.5. Let me wait for my admin to give us this. I have time to read this. Thank you very much. 0.286. Just for confirmation's sake to avoid mistakes. The next question.
Thank you very much. I think this is even done by the owner of the question, maybe during the exam. So I don't think this one should give us any problem. Maybe I should leave this one for the guys to do. 17, you convert 17 plus 273 as 290 Kelvin. That's just the most important thing of this, and the temperature here as 373 Kelvin. I hope students remember. This is something I did in the physics stuff using Chasse's law. So when the pressure remains the same, then you can use this that is being used here, V1 over T1 is equals to V2 over T2. So directly, you can just substitute the values, and if you do that very well, on what my admin is giving me the sign here, my admin is saying 161, am I right? So this would be V1 is 125, T1 is 290, then V2, the volume, the second volume is what you are looking for over the temperature is 373. So cross multiply here and make V2 so a formula. This is what you are looking for. So thank you very much, admin, for your help. The next one. Yes, that's very good. This is a resounding winning. Let's move on. What is the first ionization energy? Oh, not what, but why? Don't mind me, I'm actually looking at something. That's why I'm laughing here. Why is the first ionization energy of phosphorus greater than that of silicon? So now we can say, now it's very simple. This is because of the inner core. And majorly we always say ionization energy is inverse in proportional to size. So, but because of what we call Z effective, we've talked about this. Watch my concept video on your inorganic, you are going to know what I'm talking about. So, by and large, guys, so the outer electron of phosphorus is here. The atomic radius of phosphorus is greater. If it is greater, you expect what? Ionization energy to go down. As ionization is inversely proportional to size. Phosphorus has one more proton in its nucleus. The outer electron of phosphorus is more shielded, yes. So that is Z effective, and that is the reason why, as you increase that, ionization energy tends to increase. The next one. Thank you very much. Which of the following pairs exhibit the most similar chemical property? Which of them belongs to the same what? The same group. You understand that? And that is just the logic of Mendeleev's periodic table. Now, from this, we can actually look at their position. And look at this, is a Ca2+. So this and this will be in the same group. This will be the answer. Nothing to solve. So next one. I hope you guys are getting this. The next one says, which of the following metal is not in the first row transition element? First row transition element is from 21 to 30. Element from 21 to 30. So if you have studied element from 21 to 30, chemistry teacher way, chemistry teacher logic, chemistry science teacher method, that is what I always call this. So if you want to learn my science teacher method, you can actually enroll in my online classes. I'll teach you all these chemistry teacher methods to know all elements in the periodic table. So without any further delay, we can say manganese is there. So the knowledge, there's even abbreviation, 21, element from 21 to 30. That's first row of transition method. So if you want to know them, now you know. So all these elements are there. Vanadium is there, STV, CMNF. These are abbreviations. So, but if you don't study it, you may not know it. So we are only considering elements from 21 to 30 at the first row of transition. So these guys know there, and that will be the answer to the question. The next one. Now, which of the following ions have noble gas electronic configuration? Noble gas is group 18 element. Mostly periodic table. Hope you guys know the modern periodic table is designed by Henry Mosley. And if you go by that, let me give you science teacher method. This is very simple to know. The answer, this is group 17. It has gained one. That is group 18, correct? This is also the same thing. This is group, very correct. Because this one is in group 1. So if it's losing one electron, it goes back to group 18. The same thing to this one, but this one is in group 14. Tin, you know the family of tin. Tin is in group 14. So if tin is losing two electrons, group 14 losing two electrons will be group 12. So it can never be group 18. You are looking for which one fall to group 18 because noble gas are group 18 in your modern period. So tin is in group 14. You know the family: carbon, silicon, germanium, tin, lead, and fluorine. Watch my concept video. All this is very simple. So the answer is the one I circle. Please always note that. Next one, guys. Next one. Thank you very much.
In which of the following compound is the anion most polarized? Talking about polarization of a compound, it's simple. The one that has the highest size, we have the highest what? Polarization. So each of them are lithium. These are concepts of lithium, anomalous behavior of lithium, diagonal behavior between lithium and magnesium. I hope you have studied it. And if you have not, there's always a fork sign to everything in this line. So, way by that, which of them, everything is lithium. So, use the group 17 logic. Which one has the highest size? Fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, astatine, and what? Tennis. I hope you guys still remember tennis. Now, that is that. But for now, the out of all this one, fluorine is smaller. Follow is chlorine, followed by bromine. So, iodine is the highest size. It has the highest polarization. The next one, please. The next question. Thank you very much. Oh wow, colligative property. So this is under your what? Inorganic as well. Colligative property does not depend on the nature of a substance, only depends on the concentration of what? Of the solid. The next one, nothing to solve, that is why I'm just speaking on such about. Next one, please. Thank you very much. This says, what is the coordination compound? Coordination chemistry, coordination compound is also important of this and of the central coordination number and the oxidation state. Now, let us get the coordination number from this particular. There is no what? Cation. We only have central ion. So chlorine is mono. So chlorine is 2 there. We can say 2 plus. I hope you have studied this. So this is bidentate. When I say bidentate, you know that means 2 times 2. What is 2 times 2? 4. 2 plus 4 is equals to 6. So nickel is having what? A coordination number of 6. So we can look at the option. This guy and this guy is out. For coordination number, then for oxidation number of nickel, nickel is X. Everybody know that this is minus 1, then this is a 0. You know that very well. So we can say X. I'm doing the normal thing, you guys know very well. X normal plus 2 times minus 1 minus 2. Everybody know how to calculate OS. When I say OS, I miss oxidation state. 2 times 0 is equals to 0, and everything is equals to 0. You guys know X plus times minus is a minus. Anything plus 0 is still that thing. When you solve this guy, what is your answer for X? X answer will be equals to 2. So oxidation number OS is 2. Coordination number is 6. 6 and 2 is the most correct. So guys, be careful about this. It's going to come out. Coordination compound, please study that very well. You can use Wenner's theory. It's also my video. If you want to learn more, you can watch. Please go back to the next one. This will be whatever else you do. So, because I'm seriously, this particular topic is very important for you to watch clearly. Because I don't want to rush. Because you might be asking me, how do I get coordination number? It's simple. Just look at what they combine with. So if you look at what they combine with, you will be able to know. And you just need to know what? So more than there are about 16, you have to know your syllabus. Please learn that. The next one, please. Thank you. Now, excess soil acidity caused by acid rain have been neutralized by quicklime. I don't think that one should be a problem about for you guys. This is a very quick one. So you cannot, if you add more fertilizer to acid, fertilizer also contain acid. You know that. Molten cryolite, you cannot use cryolite. Molten cryolite is Na3AlF6. So you don't have this one. If you add, is this brine or brine? I think they want to write brine. Because if it is caustic NaOH, also is wrong. So, but when you add this one, it reacts with it and what to dissolve and neutralize the what the acidic content in it. The next question. Now, which of the following is an X block element? I think this one is also a very cheap question for every one of you to get. Science teacher method. I told you science teacher method. We can list the group of each of them. Everybody knows this is the answer. This is in group one, S block. Group one and group two is an S block element. This is group 1. I do know group 1, lithium, sodium, potassium, cesium, and francium. Now, I'm not going to that further. Everybody knows this is group 18, this is group 17, this is group 18. So this is the answer. And this one, group 13 to 18, is the P block element. You have studied that. Group 1 and 2 are the S block element. The next question. Thank you very much. Now, use the following data to determine the change of formation of solid of the standard enthalpy change of formation for solid IC3.
My admin, I can see you. Thank you very much. You are really doing a great job. I can see your hand asking me to increase the size of this. So I hope this is okay for them to manage. Thank you very much. Now, here we can actually solve this using the concept of, I don't know, I don't understand, should write yellow. Is yellow should be? Are you sure? They can see it? Okay. Now, use the following data to determine the standard interval. It is this that I want to produce. So I don't need to waste my time. How can I produce this? You can see this is ICE and this is, what's this guy? This is ICL. So what I can do is that whatever I want to do here, I just have, both of them is having this. I want to produce this alone. So you just need to just obey the rule. Remove this guy because it also has the combo. How can he remove two? That is half. So half of the first equation using LC's law, half of 14 plus minus 88. I hope this thing is showing. So if that is the case, it's showing now. Okay. So half of 14 is 7 plus 9 minus is minus minus 88. 7 minus 88 will give me negative 81 kilojoule, and that will be the answer to this. So the next question. For the first time, I'm using the yellow soap. Now, the oxide of nitrogen used in mild anesthetic surgery, laughing gas. Everybody know, and laughing gas is really nice. Now, nitrogen, one oxide. Choice C, choice B is correct. The next one. Next one. Memory-based question. You don't need to waste time on that. Thank you very much. Next one is, which of these reactions in equilibrium is unaffected by change in pressure? You should understand how to determine equation that is all what? Reversing reaction that is not affected by change in pressure. Two conditions. If it is not in gaseous form, that's the first condition. And the second condition is to compare the number of moles. Please concentrate. The number of moles here are what you are going to use to cancel out a lot of things. So if it has equal number of moles, pressure has little or no effect. Now, let's check which one has equal number of moles in both reactant and product. It's not this. It's not this. Hope you understand. This is two at this side. This is three. They're looking for the one that cancels out, that balances out. So that is how we determine this. So it's not this one and two is also. In fact, they did not even give you the state of matter, though this house will gas. But it is this. How did I know it's this? Two is here. One plus one. One plus one is also two. So that's how we do this. And I don't think this one should. This is elementary. It's not A level as far as I'm concerned. And that should be the way you are also concerned. So do you understand? So let's move on. The next question, please. There are solid 50 questions. I don't know where we are. Admin can. Is the only book a question 34 or 50? Thank you very much, admin. Now, this says the trihalides of phosphorus. Halide means when phosphorus, we said under the concept of halogenous compound, we said we can combine what the phosphorus can react with what? With halogen to give us what? Two type, limited amount and excess amount. That is phosphorus trichloride and phosphorus pentachloride. Remember PCl3 and PCl5. We've talked about this. So what this one is telling us is that the trihalide of phosphorus, now we add with water to form. So when, let's take a very simple example, PCl3 dissolved in water will now form which of these? It's very simple. From the concept of this is H3PO3. As you can see, H3PO3. H3PO3 is always what is going to be formed plus the other product. So it's always H3PO3. When trihalide dissolved, it is what? H3PO3. So if we remove H3PO3 here, you know what you have. We are going to have, you have chlorine. That is mean what? So the answer to that is I'm looking for H3PO3, and this is a very simple question to be honest. The next one. Now, question 35. Which of the following halides is the most acidic? We've talked about this under my concept. This is why you need to what, sit down and watch all those simple concept video on the periodic table. I do say it. The more you know the periodic table, the more you understand chemistry. That's just one thing. That's why I started with periodic table with content. When all periodic table stuff has been known, then you now go into some other topics that is quite easy to know. So far, you have introduced yourself to it. So without wasting time, I have talked about acidity of what? Of halogen. The acidity of halogen decreases like this. It is like fluorine, chlorine, bromine,
and what iodine is there on the channel. So what I'm trying to say is that the last one is having the great work, is the most acidic. But when it comes to stability, it's the other way around. So it's there. So please note that this is for acidity and this is for stability. So the answer to what iodine, iodide, is going to have the what the most acidic what iodine. So the next one. Now, the next one, coordination chemistry again, naming coordination compound. I think you have also studied this before in your tutorial centers and what coaching institute as well as your university centers. Now, the IUPAC name of FeF4H2O2-. So be careful because this is having minor. So this tells you that all the elements or compound inside is what? Negative. And when it is negative, you know what we call the cation at the central atom. The central atom will not be pronounced as its name. It will change to what? Ferrite. And the logic your teacher might have explained to your lecturer is that you start with the ligand. The ligand are the ones that are inside the bracket. So the ligand here is what? H2O. So how do you pronounce water? It's called aqua. So how many mole of aqua? That is two. What do you call two? Di. This is di aqua. So let's start everything as di aqua. Very good. Now, then after that we have fluorine. What is the mole of fluorine? Four. That is tetrafluoro. Everything has tetrafluoro. I hope you can see everything has tetrafluoro. Very good. So that means you are getting there. Then the next thing, you don't call it ion because this is negative. If it is positive, there is no cation here. If it is positive, it is called iron, but because it is negative, iron will be what? Ferrite. So please note that. So we are going to cancel the one that has iron. How many get iron here now? This is iron. This is iron. So we are having diaqua. We have diaqua tetrafluoro. Tetrafluoro. I want to see the difference between these. Tetrafluoro. Then ferrite. 3. Oxidation number you can calculate should be 3. Oxidation number of this is 0. So you know how to do this. It should be 3. Everything has 3. You will not even disturb yourself to cancel. So, ion. Abi, we don't say that. If you say diaqua tetrafluoroferrite 3 is an ion because minus a number. Now, when you calculate the oxidation number, you're going to equate it to minus 1. But we don't need this because everything here is 3. So we cancel this and we pick which one is left now. Choice B. So choice B is the most correct answer according to this one. So next question is question 37. Thank you, Adi. Enlarge. Thank you. Now we have about this we have I hope this is visible. No. Now the reaction between hydrazine and carbonyl group, ether, you know the carbonyl group, so I don't want to go into that. Everybody should know their acanone and acana. So the reaction between hydrazine and carbonyl group will give you what we call the family of hydrozone. This is your organic chemistry 004, whatever you call it in your coaching center, hydrozone. So this is more like a Wolf-Krishna reduction method, which you might have studied. And if you've not studied, there's still time for you to study all these things. So when hydrazine combined with carbonyl compound, they give hydrazone, which are also what we say they are what the family of hydrazine. So hydrozone should be the answer here. Or if you check here, it's not this, it's not this, it's not this. Now, phenyl hydrazine is the family of hydrozone. So the correct answer to this is how. So they give hydrazine compound. So an hydrazine compound, when they dissolve, is a, what we use this method. They call it Wolf-Krishna reduction method, which I believe you have studied under your organic chemistry, especially under your what the aromatic compound reaction. So this is a very popular reaction. You guys should have studied. So hydrozone or hydrazine compound. Please note that. So an hydrazine compound about this one is what phenyl hydrazine, which I believe we can draw. But because of time, let us move on to the next question. Thank you, Adeline. This is a simple question. Which of the following is tetrary amine? Amine, tetrary amine. I don't think this one. Amines are derivative of ammonia. They are gotten from ammonia. So what they do is just primary, secondary, and tertiary is just what you remove hydrogen, you have the alkyl group. That's what we do. So if you want to get primary amine, remove hydrogen, add alkyl group. So it will be alkyl group is R. Then they move one higher through. This is primary amine. So if this secondary amine, these are simple things. So that means you have double R. So they move another hybrid, that is NH. Then you have, that is RI dash. And tertiary amine will be, you know what I mean, to be ordinary N. R2 and N. So that is the way we do this. So these are primary, secondary, and tertiary. Another way most of the teacher will teach you is that the number of alkyl group that is combined. So now let's say this one is, you know, three alkyl group must combine. This one is, you can see, this is NH, this is NH2. We need the one that is N. That's the logic. So this is the answer, and this is also wrong. So guys, the answer to this is choice C. The next question, are question 39. Thank you. Name the following organic compound. Functional group, amine. Priority order, no other functional group. Longest carbon chain. Longest carbon chain. How we name amine? So 1, 2, 3, 4, buta. Amine. Buta, 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 buta. So this is, well, let's see, we have penta. If you can see, 1, 2, 3, 4. No, 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's buta. So 1, 2, closest to the chain. That is 2. This is it. So 2 is closer than anyone. Next one. Next one. Next one. Next one. Thank you. Question 40. Heterolytic bond fission results in the formation of positively charged carbon. Positively charged carbon is called carbocation. Carbon. Positive C plus. It's called carbocation or carbonium. Carbocation. What is that? Elementary? Under your GOC, General Organic Chemistry. So this is simple. So carbocation is also known as carbonium ion. So please note that. So next one, please. I don't want to waste time because these are memory-based questions. Next one. Thank you. Which of the following statement is not true of electrolytic cell? Electrolytic cell converts electrical energy to. This is correct. A porous partition is not connected. There should be a porous partition. Let's see the option. Cathode is negative and anode is positive, is correct. Electrode are in separate. Electrode are in separate compartment. That is, we have electrode for cathode. No. There's only one electrode. So porous partition is not needed, is correct then. So this should be the answer to the question. So guys, next question. Memory-based question. Nothing to talk about electrolytic stuff. Thank you very much. The oxidation of these. Functional group is needed. Functional group is, I think I need to check. The functional group I'm seeing here is OH. As you can see, this is an alkanol. Everybody knows, so this is simple. Alkanol, this is an oxidizing agent. Oxidizing agent. So if KMnO4 is oxidizing agent, alkanol will be oxidized to what? Alkanoic acid. You know that from elementary. So you just think alkanoic acid is COOH, all these guys are out. So between this one and this one, how will you know the answer? Count the number of carbon. So it is not this number of carbon for butanoic acid. So then this is the answer. I'm sorry I'm rushing. I'm running under the time. Question 42. Thank you very much. Hydrogenation of vegetable oil to produce margarine is an example of, that is what, an addition. Yeah, so this is elementary, more of a YEC question. So it's an addition reaction. Hydrogenation of oil in the presence of catalyst. I don't know why I'm having overlapping of stuff. So it's an addition reaction. The catalyst used are nickel, platinum, palladium, and so on and so forth. They can be transition metals. Next one. Now, the enzyme suitable for the conversion of starch to maltose, that is reduction of what? Carbohydrates, you understand? Maltose, or starch is a polysaccharide. Maltose is what? That is a disaccharide. So you need what? A chemical, alcohol, a catalyst, which we call what? Diastase. Yes, diastase. So diastase is needed to convert starch to maltose. The next question, memory-based question, nothing to solve. Thank you very much. Now, this one says, what type of reaction does this long compound does not undergo? Now, we need to know how many carbon are there and how many hydrogen. From here, I can count. Carbons are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. There are 6 carbon, and 6 C's, and there are 12 hydrogen. 3 plus 2 is 5. 5 plus 1 is 6. 6 plus 2 is 8. I've missed one. I've missed this guy. 3 plus 2 is 5. 6, 7, 9, 12. C6H12. What is the name? This is what? Hexene. Double bond. So hexene does not undergo substitution reaction. Only alkene undergo substitution reaction. So the answer to this is substitution reaction. As a reaction, this guy does not undergo.
Next one. Thank you very much. The compound with molecular formula C5H12 has dash isomerism. Pentane has three isomer, memory base. So you can three isomers. Pentane, which is normal pentane, 2-methylbutane, which is iso pentane, and 2-2-dimethylpropane,
which is new pentane. I hope you guys still remember memory-based question. But all the same,
you can as well try to use the formula as limitation. That's why they don't give people online the formula. It only works from what? 1 to 7. So anything that is above 7, it will not work. 5 carbon atom, 5 minus 1. This is the formula, 2 raised to the power n minus 4 plus 1. So there are limitations. That's why I don't teach online when I'm doing this. I don't use this. So 5 minus 4 is 1. 2 raised to the power 1 plus 1. So 2 plus 1 is going to be 3 isomers. And I think that is okay. The next one. Now, question 47, we are almost there. So we have considered this structure. We can see the structure. This is aromatic compound. Then we are combining with carbon. And we are told that water.
Very good.
So we are talking about substrate, organic compound, talking about electronic structure. Now, we are to talk about which electronic effect is likely to be observed here. Now, in this type of effect, if you have studied the concept of how the root of your organic chemistry, you know what I mean, substrate plus attacking agent, then plus what, the mechanism, then you have what, the product, whatever. I'm not going into that. But the first one, there are two types of what, electronic effect. We have positive, permanent and temporary. And you know we have different types. So one of them is called inductive effect, hyperconjugation. You have learned this. I'm very sure you have learned this. So in this case, the only effect that is visible here is that the plus I minus I plus I, because you know we talk about carbon, the one that has the tendency of what, the ability that has the highest polarization that can pull electrons to itself, electronegativity concept. So here is about the plus I and the what, minus I. So the plus I minus I effect is called what, the inductive effect, because that is the exact thing we can talk about in this. It is not tautomeric effect, because this thing is not what, it's not cannot be interchanged. It is not a steric effect, you know what we call stereoisomerism. This is not stereoisomerism. It is not an electromeric effect, but what, a kind of plus ion minus ion effect, which is called inductive effect. The next question. Thank you very much. Now, the following compounds, this is amine. We talk about the functional group. You can see each of them is having, this is amine, primary, but this guy is not primary. This is secondary amine. Talk about that. How to know that NH2 is primary, NH is secondary, then N only is tertiary. I hope you still remember. So they are not what? They are not chain isomer, because do they have the same number of carbon atom? No. This, only few of them has the number of carbon, so they are not isomer. Anything isomer, you can hang it up. That is wrong. So now, primary amine. Not everything here is primary amine. As one there is what? Secondary amine. So these things are number of homologous series. So they are homologous. Everything here are wrong. So I hope you guys understand what I did. So that is how to get answer to that. The next question. The last but one. Which of the following reaction is suitable for synthesis of alkanes? Alkene, synthesis of alkene. So to synthesize alkene, now you just need to understand something. The reaction required to get alkenes is what? You have dehydration of alkane. I think it's the presence of what? Dehydrating agent, H2SO4. C2H5OH. At the temperature about 175 and above, then you are going to have C2H4 in the presence of H2SO4 dehydration. So the addition of alcohol, it's not oxidation, it's not reduction, it's not hydrolysis, but the addition of alcohol in the presence of H2SO4 that acts as a dehydrating agent. If temperature is lower than this, this is going to give you an ether, an alkoxy. So please note that that's another question you might be asked. So be careful about that. Let's move to the last question
of today.
Thank you very much.
So the last question, this one I'm going to stop, guys. The last question is, branch chain isomers have the following property when compared with their linear isomers. Which property? We know we've learned about this. I think this is also elementary when we start hydrocarbons. So when you start the topic of hydrocarbons, you are going to be talking about the normal form of the linear isomers or the linear chain, the normal chain, do have what? High melting and boiling point. High boiling point and high melting point. The reason is because, you know, when you talk about isomers, isomers are branched in. They start with spreading their wings. The moment they spread out, it's just like arranging a game of Tetris. If some things are like this, you can see their molecules are close to each other. They have high melting and boiling because they are forming something like what? A lattice. You understand that? So before you can break them, you require high heat. You understand? But when something is now being spread, and this one is having a branch, and you can see it's easy to break this one because they have a long chain. So that is why branch chain always have a low melting point and a low boiling point compared to the other. So you should always keep that. So branch chain are going to have low melting point. So anything high, low melting point, low boiling point, low melting point. So this one is also out. Then the last thing is density. Now density concept is density is mass over volume. So what has higher density? What has higher volume? We have low density because that's inverse relation. So definitely we know a branch chain is going to have what? A low amount of density because they have high volume, because the space they are occupying is greater than the space in which a normal straight chain is what occupying. You can see branching are those one like 2-methylbutena, they are very long. New pentane, all those stuff. So what I'm trying to tell you guys is to understand this, because volume of a branch chain is wider than that of a straight chain. So the one that has highest volume, we have low density. So that is why here I'm going for low density, low melting point, and low whatever. So I think this is the right answer. Not that I think, I'm very sure this is the answer. So guys, this is the solution to all 2020 examination. If time permits me, I'll also help you do the last year one. I think I have the question as well, so that you guys can be well prepared for your forthcoming examination. So if you are new to this channel, you can consider subscribing. I'll see you guys soon. Do have a wonderful time, and bye for now.